on a spinning ball, and they all mean the world to you. It's times like these that I feel so small. There must be something I can do. I played it safe in shallow water. Never had the faith to cross the border. God, I've gotten good at being comfortable. It's time to leave my comfort zone. 'Cause you said go.
Welcome, everybody, to our Fishers for Men, Digging for the Truth. And this is our Sunday stream that sometimes is pre-recorded, like today. Other times it's not. And what we're kind of trying to do is basically we're going to be trying to get some common ground here. We're going to talk about common ground, talk about common ideals. And, of course, we're Christians, so we're coming from the Christian perspective. But we believe that for any kind of truth to survive and keep going, there has to be tolerance, which we don't really have. And so we always try to bring up something that kind of, from the Christian's perspective, and obviously we want to get more people to talk so we have more, a fish, trophy seafoam. More perspectives and get some guest stars. It's kind of like a talk show radio, but with awesome video games, right? That's the idea. Oh my goodness, you can do it. And of course, what do we do doing this? Fishers for Men, Digging for the Truth. Amoeba's out digging treasure, and I'm fishing, and we're gonna be talking. So today's topic is forgiveness. The first thing we're going to talk about and what we're going to need when we're talking about this kind of thing is we got to define the word. So that's something I kind of learned in my first year of college here, is that whenever you got to talk about a subject and discuss it, you got to... Trophy Indigo Splashtail! What? Man. This is going sideways fast. I got to sit closer. We had everything go wrong today. Our printer crapped out. It's broken. It's overheated. We had people kill. I was gone trying to print something off and before it died. And Amoeba got attacked by these guys right off the bat. She was just trying to give him a humble gift. It was just everything was just gone so wrong. The first piece of paper for this little speech we made here is just absolutely disappeared. It was just kind of one of those, like, super odd moments. Like, I flipped couches over. It's gone. I have no idea. I don't know if we're ever going to find it. And which is kind of okay, I guess, in some ways. Maybe we will, but either way, I'm just like, okay. What abysmal portal did that go down? So, these are all things that... when things go wrong, we get, emotions get high. You can ask me, but we automatically went into our fight or flight responses for our relationship, which is, mine is, get super frustrated, but pretend I'm not, right? So, because I'm hoping to calm down, I'm hoping to keep my, you know, keep collected and not get overly emotional. That's really what I'm shooting for. Hers is to kind of do the same thing, actually, but try to get everybody else to try to control the situation by getting everybody else to stay calm so I don't get more upset. So we're trying to, like, defuse the situation with fire. Well, like you're out of gunpowder cake. If anybody's watched our stream, you know that is about as good as giving Club Cashew a cake. Right? It's gonna go off. It's just more of a matter of when. But we gotta define it. So what would you think? Well, how would you define that? They're biting. What would you say forgiveness is?
Forgiveness is my definition would be letting go of something that would hindering me from loving somebody.
Yeah, I think that pretty much hits it on the nail head. Okay, the etymology, or where this word comes from. The history of the word, we get it from the Old English, which goes back to a Germanic, because that's where Angles and Saxons originally, thousands of years ago, or over 1,000 years ago, came from. But the idea is this, is that it's from the word for, right, and give. And that sounds super obvious, but to be honest, I thought it was going to be way more complicated. It's not. However, the definition for is not quite the same one that we use. I'm sure English teachers probably could nail this, Pat. Like, they would know exactly what we're talking about. Because the definition of the word for in this is means all. I think we kind of don't think about maybe as much about it. Or at least I don't. I know I certainly don't, because I'm like, when I looked this up, I was actually kind of shocked. Like, I love English and words. I'm nerdy like that. But that's why I'm good at the PVE part. Let's get to the next part. So, the word give. And I think that's almost self-explanatory, right? It comes from the old English, to grant or allow to remit a debt, meaning, or to pardon an offense, to give up, to give in marriage, or for, you know, it's to, when you add the word for, to completely give. So, it has a special correlation, meaning that, like, when you put the word for in there, the whole thing changes. It becomes unique and absolutely golden. You know, it's like finding the chest or catching one of these fish. It's the pinnacle of what it's supposed to be for. It's that special. It has that much extra to it. Not only is this, you know, amazing, but this is a very special concept. We want to commemorate it. We want to always remember. So I think it has this really odd, unique thing to it. And like I said, I didn't know that before this. I was like, I'm kind of shocked. So it's kind of interesting that this goes to a very old root of just meaning to have. And they even think it even goes back to the old Sanskrit. I'm probably saying this wrong, but gahavsti, which is hand or forearm, to have, to hold, to possess. Something that becomes yours. It's more than just a physical for them. It becomes conceptual right off the bat. But the first idea comes from Ephesians 4, 31 through 32. It says, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ has also forgiven you. And so this is kind of interesting to me. If you look at it, this isn't, if we just take it in the way it's written there, it's basically what he's saying is, if you're gonna forgive, you gotta put away or get rid of, you gotta forget, you gotta let go, as Amoeba says, of everything that is malice, that is intentionally evil, meaning that you are intentionally going to cause harm. And what they're saying is, this isn't something that... You can say this is a good golden line. This is a way to say, you know you've succeeded on helping cleanse yourself or get rid of this nasty feelings and thoughts, this bad way of thinking, if you've gotten rid of all the anger and wrath and bitterness and the slander and the clamor. If you're not doing those things, then you've forgiven. This is what we're trying to achieve, right? And I think, just in my opinion, but I think this is something that we can all agree with, right? I'm not going to go out and try to hurt other people at a mall or something or a school in a game or at work or anywhere if I've letting all these things go, right? If I'm acting this way, I'm just not going to be bitter. I'm just going to let it go because you know what? It's not worth it. I can feel sorry for them. So as we can see, Ephesians 4 talks about this different type of thinking. It's not just us as Christians who are saying like the type of thinking is what's important. We can actually see the same sort of thing in one of our favorite TV shows, Doctor Who. Season 9, Episode 8, The Zygon Inversion. So, just a quick introduction.
Babe.
If you're not. Yes, darling.
Look at my screen.
Oh, that's good to know. Time to go.
What about the rowboat?
We don't have a lot of time. Okay. Is he coming after us?
I don't know.
Let me get a better look. Yeah, he's sailing away.
Okay.
So you see it? We can see his back flag really well.
Yeah.
And then the lights are kind of separated. So the two lights that are closest are the two lights on front of your boat. Those are the closest together, right? And then the light that is the farthest away is going to have the larger gap. That's on the back of the boat. So if you see it like that, you know if you can see the flag and that light, and those are close, that he's sailing away from you. Thank you, Jesus. That was a good little interrupt. Get my head back where I was. I'm talking too fast. Anyways, where was I? I think I was saying something about Doctor Who, Season 9, Episode 8. It's called The Zygon Inversion. And of course, the one before is The Zygon Invasion. It's a British show, actually based out of where they're shooting it, is in Wales. Absolutely love it. They've got great ways of thinking. I don't always agree with it, but I don't have to agree with everything to love it. Otherwise, that would be super conditional, wouldn't it? That'd be bad. That would be, you know, that type of thinking is what gets us into messes, and that's not good. We don't want that. So the idea is this, is that this Doctor Who guy, that's his name, Doctor Who, is in a time-traveling guy. He's got a thing called a TARDIS that goes, it travels in time and in space. So, he's super old, essentially. He doesn't really die. He, what's called regenerate, so they can constantly bring in new actors for the same guy. And it's actually a pretty smart idea, so your show continues going on. Anyways, in this one, he's trying to stop the humans and the Zygons from killing each other. So the Zygons needed a place to live, and of course, Earth was like, cool, come live here. But now they're at the point where there's going to be a war. They're having some issues. And he has designed this way, these two boxes with buttons in them. If they press one, it will kill the Zygons. If they press the other of the Zygons pressing buttons, if the other presses the other, it makes the Zygons so they can't change and look like humans anymore. Right? So that they're out in the open and inside they can take over and they can fight this battle and defeat humans and take over the planet, basically. And so in this episode, obviously, he's made up, come up with a plan where they are bared down to a choice with, between the British leader of a special unit called UNIT that represents us, and of course this Zygon person who's played by Jenna Coleman, and of course she's playing his companion, and the bad guy at the same time, because one of them's turned into her.
It's a good episode.
It is a really good episode. And that's what it's about. It's about forgiveness. So it starts off like this. So we get the doctor, who is an older southern Scottishman gentleman. That's what he sounds. And he plays the doctor, and he's kind of this grumpy old doctor. And I think it's perfect. I love him. He's one of my favorite doctors, but I probably will be a grumpy old person myself. Here it goes. He goes, "It's make your mind up time!" And the clip of this episode starts out with a blame game where the head of the humans and the head of the aliens are blaming everywhere. And of course, the head of the aliens is blaming the doctor, saying, "You're just treating us like cattle." And he goes, "So? Like I'm guiding you? Okay, that's not a big deal." And of course, he's like, "Well, it's not fair." And he goes, "Well, the world isn't fair. I don't have my own tailor, and my TARDIS is time machine doesn't always work properly." And she's like, "You just left us to fend on our own." He goes, so is everybody. That's the idea, right? And of course, then it gets, she says, of course, the situation gets worse, and she starts saying, "Well, it's your fault." And he goes, "No, it's not. It's your fault." And of course, they keep kind of trading it back, and they go back to the fair thing, and that kind of enters the new part of the conversation, as she sees that she can't kind of win an argument right there. She says that we're never going to be able to work together on this planet, is the idea. And he states, "Well, that's just your excuse for your violence beginning violence. You know, that you're not better than them, as you think. You're just a new violent person treating other people with violence, and then violence gets treated back to you." And he goes, "You're acting like a spoiled child." You know, that's the idea. She says they aren't comparable. And of course, that she states is that as her violence has done, and what he states is, "Well, what the violence you have done is a fact. It isn't something that we're just going to talk about. Well, it's not fair. No, these are things that have happened, and you're going to have to deal with them." He's simply going from one cruel act to another. He states at the end of his speech here that the only way that people can live in peace is if they are prepared to forgive. And he says, "Why don't you break the cycle?" he asks her. Right? "That's the only way we're going to stop. Why don't you break the cycle? Why don't you break the cycle?" And I think that's the question we have to ask ourselves when we get that upset. You know, as the tears are running down our faces, we're like saying constantly, "Forgive, I forgive you, I forgive you," but we're just not feeling it. Right? Are we breaking the cycle, or are we just wanting the pain to go away? Because there's a bit of a difference, isn't there? The next part, he logically walks her through. Whoa, getting attacked already. So this next part, he logically walks her through. After asking her, "What do you want of this?" And she goes, "War! You know, I want, that's what I want." And he goes, "Just like any of the other 10th ring child in history, Bunny, you don't know what you want. You think you do, but you don't." And I think that's such a true point. I think that's, we do tend to react to our more immature state, beginning back down to almost like a tampering child, you know, just absolutely irritated with how things go. And of course, he says, "What are you going to do? What are you going to do with the troublemakers, the people like you?" And of course, he states, or she says, "We're going to win. We're going to defeat him. That's the way." She's just going to beat more violence, right? We're just going to kill everybody. And we can see that actually through many different mythologies. We see through the Bible, we can see it through all kinds of different stories, not just mythologies, legends, fairy tales, whatever you want to call it. It's still the idea that violence begets violence, that the only way to protect an empire or a leadership that has started with a violent nature or this negative bully-like thinking is to continue being a bully. You can't, people don't take you seriously if you try to change. without forgiveness. Because if you think about it in a weird way, it takes two to stop fighting. One to forgive, but two to stop fighting, I guess you could say. So she gets on and he says, "No, no one wins for long. And the wheel keeps turning. You have to break the cycle." Nice. Not quite in the right place for this. That's always the hard part here, is that the line snaps if you're too close to the shore or on your boat, unfortunately. "It's always the same," he says. "No matter how many broken hearts or how many lives shattered, and it finally gets down to what should have happened in the first place, with your idea that you have no idea of who's going to die or whose children are going to pay for your war, when all you had to do in the first place was sit down and talk." And that, I think that's the beautiful part about this episode, is as it gets down to it, all people ever have to do is sit down and try to work out the problem. You can't, you're going to have to forgive. You're going to have to, you know, unless you plan to hold it till you die, you're going to have to do something about this emotional problem that has come up, right? He even points out that, as she says, of course, in this, that, "You don't understand. I've gone too far. I've done too much. They're never going to let me go with this." And of course, he says, "I don't understand. I don't understand, you know. Guess what? Well, I forgive you. You don't think you're forgivable like every other tempering child? You think, you know, I can't be forgiven. I've done too much. Well, I forgive you." I think that's super important, man. We do that too much to ourselves, beat ourselves up so much that we just don't think, you know, okay, it's too late now. You know, sometimes it's too late for those factual consequences that we've created, but that doesn't mean it's always too late to try to make it, to do something about it, to try to make up for it, to try to at least show that you want to change the way you are, change the way you think. Because changing the way you think changes the way you act. That's the only way to try to change the way you've done something, to change the future in a weird way, right?
So when the doctor's talking about...
When she says, you don't know what I've seen, and he goes, are you serious? If we take a moment to sit back and think about it, you know, higher power, God, you know, whoever you would consider in that role, you can look at it as in our faith, God. You know, he probably feels the same way. Like, we don't know what we had to deal with, you know, when we get mad on the game. They sunk us for no reason, or she took my spot in line.
He's like, are you serious? He goes, I can still forgive you, even though I've seen worse things. You know, and he's fighting a spiritual battle, so.
It's interesting how you can put a new perspective on it, and easier to forgive when you can look at it from something like that.
Well, I love what Amoeba had to say about that, because that's exactly kind of the point. It really breaks down to not wanting to give up her anger, because in the end, love and anger can't really coexist. So it's really trust and distrust can't coexist. You either do or you don't. It's not, you know, it's not a nuclear bomb, it's not a grenade, it's not an all-encompassing kind of thing. It's an on-off switch in a weird... Oh my gosh, dude.
I got it.
Get him, baby, you got him.
You want to keep this one.
And as Amoeba was saying, in order to coexist like that, it takes two, right? You have to choose. Forgiveness is something you have to do together. So in Colossians 3:12-13, the div says, "So as those who have been chosen of God, holy beloved, but put on the heart of the compassion, kindness, humility, and gentleness and patience, bearing with one another and forgiving each other. Whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as you forgave, as the Lord forgave you." In other words, what he's saying is we should always be treating ourselves with kindness and compassion, humility, gentleness, and patience in our heart. And we're trying to bear that, show that to one another, and forgiveness is a part of that. So a part of this love thing is forgiving. So it sounds weird, and that's the belief, that's the Christian core idea. And that's something that I at least believe that people who weren't Christians should try to hold us to, right? I mean, you hear this all the time of like, you know, don't judge, aren't you a Christian? Well, I mean, we can observe, you know, don't judge harshly is really what they're saying. And it should be the same. Well, shouldn't you forgive too? Like, I don't think Christians should be so upset. It should be a great reminder. You should be like, you know what, you're right. And I'm glad you brought that up, because that tells me that you know that kind of philosophy, and that's a good thing, and that you know it's a good thing. And it, you know, gives us an opening, you got to hear us rant, right? But, I mean, that should give anybody an opening that way. And the other one that would come from this is, if we're going to talk about, like, as Christians, as Jesus, this has come from our perspective, the idea, we should actually get it from the man himself, right? Why would we not? It wouldn't make sense. So we believe this is something he said. We think he said in Matthew 6:14-15, for if you forgive others for their transgressions, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, then your heavenly Father will not forgive you of your transgressions. Now, what that one's a little confusing, because in the Greek, what they're actually saying, I shouldn't say actually saying, but in the Greek, how it actually translates is it's actually more like, and this is the New King James. I like New King James. It's more closer to the actual words, but what they're saying is, it's not that God wouldn't forgive you of your transgressions. We're going to remember it says that all throughout the Bible that he does, but that he can treat you like that. In other words, he always says that if you judge harshly, he'll judge you. Be careful the way you judge others, lest you not be judged in the same way, right? So the way you judge people, so in other words, this is a dad who has no problem giving you your own medicine, or it's a mother who's like, well, I guess you got to learn it the hard way. So that's an odd concept in some ways to think of a loving person doing that, but if you're a parent, if you've been there, you realize that sometimes that is the only way. We as humans can be so stubborn that we often have to learn something the hard way, right? You could say that would be the story of Adam and Eve. That's the story. Well, let's just say it's a very clear, easy philosophical idea that we can go, yeah, no, unfortunately, that's true. And so forgiveness works the same way. So good and bad work the same way. So when we're forgiven, sometimes that's the best way for us to learn to develop that part of love further and greater. And we find out that this isn't just a Christian thing. We've talked about it in other ways, but something I actually found interesting today as I was trying to research other, because obviously I'm not as familiar with other religions and other belief systems, but I wanted to research it because I don't want it just to be a Christian talk. I want this to be a place where we can all come together and be able to find the truth together, because we're fishers for men digging for the truth, right? Ooh, all of plentiful things. Go here. So on TEDx, Camellia Kemp tells us that she's saying that she was saying that the word forgive doesn't really mean anything. It doesn't seem necessary is what she's saying. But what she explains as she goes over this that's her opener or intro to catch people's attention. What she explains is this process that I would use the word for forgiveness for is what is necessary for healing. She says ways through her journey through different beliefs and teachings have taught her through these different wise men that she learned from is that the soul in this process of trying to heal itself sometimes forgets to love. That when you forget to love, that you can't forgive, and that's what I would say. But she's saying that we as humans forget that love is important on this thing. And she says as she starts out that she started out crying, spending a week, days and days and hours through weeks and weeks saying, I forgive you, I forgive you, I forgive you. And that nothing changed for her. And I would say, yeah, I could believe that totally, because just saying the words isn't really it. It's a process. It's an action. It's a decision, and it's something we actually have to do. As Amoeba said, it's an action. It's something we have to do in order to make it happen. Because love, patience, kindness, all these other things we explain as love, are things we actually have to do. You have to put the work in. It can stink to do it. And we call it, when it really stinks to do it, we call that sacrifice. And we often say, well, that's the best kind of love. That's why really how you know when someone loves you is when they decide to not do something that they like to do, but to do something that you like to do. So we're running out of some bait. Let's talk about bait a little bit. So in these grassy areas is where you're going to find earthworms. And you're going to find leeches where water and sand meet. And you're going to find grubs just in the sand. And sometimes you'll find areas where it's closer to the water, but it's still grass, and they'll still count it as leeches. But since we're up this high, we're not near water, really. And these, we should get nothing but grubs up here. There we go. Or not grubs, but earthworms. And that's what we need for what we're doing up here. Perfect, perfect, perfect. And there's Amoeba. She's solving riddles once more. Solving life's riddles. Why? Because she's a mom. That's what moms do, right? Solving life's riddles. Mama, I'm thirsty. Mama, I'm hungry. I think we kind of do the same thing. Daddy, I don't feel good. Daddy, I'm upset. Daddy, I'm mad. Mama, I'm mad. I'm upset. You hurt me again. Solving life's riddles. What do you do with that? Well, you know, even though we have different point of view, I could definitely say that in our definitions of this word forgiveness are different. I would at least agree that what she's talking about in the most part, in the most basic sense of learning to love again, treating people with love, and that this journey that she talks about that's necessary for healing, that's the one I would call forgiveness. And that is, yeah, that is necessary for learning to become more of a better person. In fact, one of my favorite ones is from Steve Harvey. It's a small clip, and I think I can play it without really getting in trouble. I want to play it directly from Steve Harvey's words, because I think half our problem sometimes, as amoebas, as we started this out, defining what love is, I think sometimes as humans, half our issue is when we really get hurt, we get completely confused on what we think forgiveness is, what we think that definition is. And I think that's super important to try to remember that and try to like get to the core of it, because it's very easy to get confused. We change our minds, and that's why we get confused, right? So let me play this little bit from Steve Harvey. He has this beautiful thing, and it just helps you clear it up. It sounds a little harsh, but you know, if you watched his show, Family Feud, you know this guy doesn't mind competition, but he's actually really nice. He's a sweetheart when it gets down to it.
If you forgive a person, but you hang on to the anger, the pain, and the hurt, and you say you forgave the person, then you don't understand what forgiveness really is. Forgiveness is not for the other person. It's for you. What you don't understand about not experiencing true forgiveness, not letting it go, was explained to me this way. When you don't forgive a person, it's like you drinking the poison, waiting on them to die.
And that's exactly right. He's nailed it. That's what I'm talking about. That's what she's talking about. It's if you have to let go of these, and let's be honest, we make fun of each other, me and my wife always talking about not letting go. In reality, it has nothing to do, because we're from different cultures, we look different, genetically, all this other stuff. But realistically, when it gets down to it, because we have all the same components, we still act pretty much the same. I could sit here and it's like defining which cultures are stubborn, right? There's plenty of people, all those stubborn Germans, or all those stubborn Americans, all those stubborn Spanish. Well, we're all stubborn, right? It comes down to just we're human. And we do stupid things. And we have a commonality in those stupid things, don't we? And we have a commonality in the grand things we do, too. I mean, we have often invent things together that are this pretty much the same idea. And the outer skin might be a little different. But But like those two guys there, it's pretty much the same. One's protecting the other. We need to do that more often. So, it's a grand thing that this sort of idea that we can both... Ooh, wow, that was close. That we do, it's learning to let go. Never what we want to call it, the process and the idea stays the same. And that, in my opinion, is the real... That's the important part. That's the one that really matters, right? Hey, look at this. I saved this for a reason. Nope. No! Ba-ba-ba-ba! Ra-sha-sha-sha-sha! It is the responsibility of the person who wronged to go and initiate the process of being sorry. However, it is the person who's been wronged that they're going to still have to deal with their own emotions. And that's really the important part. And that's what Steve Harvey is saying, is why sit there and let the bitterness get worse and worse? It would be like drinking poison expecting the other person to die. That would be ridiculous. So, and that helps us really conceptualize and get in our mind this idea of what should we do with it? There is an idea of not letting ourselves be duped or hoodwinked, however, in this, and let our emotions be taken advantage of. We get the same idea with Peter turning around, walking away, taking his foot off. Like, it's not always let them come back, but they even talk about this idea of if the person's truly sorry. So it's, we are to be careful, to guard ourselves, but we also want to be able to deal with these emotions. They have different words for forgiveness for this reason, because there's different styles of forgiving. There's different styles of learning to love again, different styles of dealing with our hurt emotions. And that is super important. And as Christians, the bar in which we're really set to is what we find here in John, 1 John chapter 1, 8 through 10. It says, if we say that we have no sin, and we are deceiving ourselves, if we're saying we don't make mistakes, that we don't, we're not, that we're perfect, that, you know, we're holding ourselves over someone else, we deceive ourselves. We're lying to ourselves. And the truth is, and we're not telling the truth because it's not in us, that's what they're saying. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive our sins and cleanse of us of all unrighteousness. And if we say that we have not sinned, then we make him a liar, and that his word is not in us. So what it's saying is that we all make mistakes, and that we have to remember that. That's what's going to help us keep meek, humble. That's what's going to help us forgive. Is that we don't know the future. We could make a worse mistake than that person and have a different perspective, a better perspective at that point. It's kind of interesting that the staying humble is the key. And I really believe humility is the key to God's thinking like God. I wanted to end these ideas with what we get from Luke 17, 3 through 4. And this is the don't be fooled. Like, it's not saying that, and I want to stress it because I think a lot of people, problem with this forgiveness idea is we start to think it's like this endless idea of letting someone just walk all over you. That Christianity or the philosophies that we can see that have more than, that can be shared in more than one idea system and belief or philosophy is that it's not about being duped. It's not about letting someone take advantage of you over and over again. It's there's a deeper meaning to it. So it's be on your guard, Luke says. If your brother sins, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you 7 times a day and returns 7 times and says, I repent, you know, he's serious about it, forgive him. Because, you know, if you think about it, addiction, trying to break something that's dangerous like that, that's not just taking food or something. That is a repeated offense that we're going to have real hard time with and really need some leniency to try to actually change. That is going to require that to get out of that style of repeated dangerous thought process is going to require that, because that person can be serious every time. They can hate the idea and the philosophy and the ways they do things. They can hate the drugs. They can hate the alcohol. They can hate, I mean, there's many things people get stuck on. That's really, you know, if you think about it, that's kind of what addiction is. There's many things that people get stuck on, and they often do hate it. I have a little bit of an idea of what that's like. And so, it's not about letting yourself be duped as much as what we can do, what we can teach that other person through us deciding to love again. And that's a powerful thing. You can change people's lives. You never know who's going to be the next one to help change the world for a better place. And often, those people come from some of the darkest areas, man. Those people come or have lived in ways that we may not all agree with. Like you never know who's going to be the world changer. When it comes down to it, I think what it really boils down to is we have to make that decision to let things go. We have to make the decision to want to learn to love again and learn to love past where we were in that moment when we got hurt. You got to learn to want to see that person for maybe who they are. Maybe they're not as this hero we think, or maybe they're not the maybe they're just not that best person we thought. Maybe we're not going to have the relationship we've always wanted. Maybe in turn, it's going to be more about helping, loving that person through them, helping them see their own faults so that we can help them grow to become more. And the only way to do that is to learn to love again, to let go of the anger and bitterness and all those things, to not drink the poison and expect the other person to die. Maybe we have to think about it as our watch, as it says in Doctor Who. So, we appreciate you guys, the men. Slán, till next time.